Good morning. Thank you. It is my honor and delight to offer the welcome of this congregation, Central Baptist Church, to you for the 2024 Henson Lectures. And most likely the most helpful thing that you will hear me say today is our Wi-Fi connection information. And so if you need to find a Wi-Fi connection, look at Welcome to Central, and the password is peaceful, all lowercase, one L, one word. Each Sunday as we worship in this space, we light the Christ candle recognizing the presence of Christ. And I think I just, hang on a minute. Okay, just push play when you get there. I touched the computer and it started to run, which made me a lot more nervous than I think our guest. We light the Christ candle, recognizing the presence of Christ in us, among us, and beyond us. And in the recognition of that simple, shining light, I welcome you. Join me as we pray together. We offer to you, O living and loving God, this our prayer in silent preparation and gratitude for the gift of this day. Eager for the wisdom and insights we will gain from today's lectures, we pray that our ears may be unclogged, our thoughts be uncluttered, and our anxieties be relieved from too many noisy and unhelpful distractions. Instead, open our eyes to see your world more clearly, so that with patient minds and brave hearts, we can receive your truth and love as you speak to us and through us. What a great day is before us. May we receive it gladly in the presence of Christ, who is in us, among us, and beyond us. Amen. Amen. Recognize Dr. David Cassidy, president of BSK.
Thank you, Mark. Mark did not mention, probably because he knows how much trouble we are, but this is not only the host church for the Henson Lectures this year, this is the host church for the offices, the main offices for BSK. So we have faculty offices here, my office is here, staff offices are here. It's been a wonderful community to be part of. They have welcomed us and care for us. Thank you for being a wonderful host church. We also have offices in Louisville, Kentucky at Crescent Hill Baptist Church. And the pastor, co-pastor of Crescent Hill is here, Jordan, who happens to be an alum. I want to welcome you this morning to the 2024 Henson Lectures. You may or may not be aware, but we began these lectures in 2009, making this, if my math is correct, the 16th Henson Lecture event that we've held. 16 years. And they've been fascinating years, each one. So I welcome you to these lectures. If this is your first time, welcome. If this is a return trip for you and you've been to other Henson Lectures, we welcome you back. We also want to welcome our students. We have students attending from across the country via Zoom this morning. And so if you're a student at BSK, we welcome you and know that you'll get a lot out of the events of today. BSK has, over the last few years, become a national school. We began as a regional school, but we have grown to not only serve Kentucky and surrounding areas, but really we are now in over 16 states with students who are pursuing graduate theological education. Our partnerships are part of what helps us to grow and empower us. We have partnerships that go back to our founding with the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship Global, as well as several state cooperative Baptist fellowship groups. Kentucky, for sure. Bob Fox, I believe, is here. Hey, Bob, the coordinator for Kentucky CBF. We also have a formal partnership with CBF of Virginia and with CBF of Florida and the Caribbean Islands. So BSK is expanding our work in different parts of the country in order to fulfill our mission. We also have expanded our offerings. We have a wide variety of ways that you can flexibly engage theological education, anywhere from our 9-hour graduate certificates in different areas like pastoral care, Black church studies, and other fields. Or we now have a new Master of Arts degree, a 36-hour Master of Arts degree that will launch this fall. And of course, our Master of Divinity degree. I hope you will find a way to connect with BSK as you pursue or know others who are looking to pursue theological education. The Henson Lectures honor the life and work of Dr. E. Glenn Henson by inviting lecturers who share his passion for Christian scholarship in and for the life of the church and the world. Dr. Henson wanted to be here today, and he sends his greetings, his excitement about the lectures we will enjoy today. But he was unable to make it today. But I wanted you to know that he was thinking about us and eager to hear stories from today's events. Dr. Glenn Henson, if you don't know, spent his long career in seminary education across many seminaries, most recently as senior professor of church history and spirituality at BSK. His teaching and writings have inspired so many of us. Across the 16 years of the lectures, we have been blessed to have many wonderful speakers, including Dr. Danielle McCray, Dr. Willie Jennings, Ruby Sales, and others. So I now ask that Dr. Laura Levins, our Associate Professor of Christian Mission, come and introduce for us today our distinguished lecturer.
Yes, all praise and just excitement for our lecture today. So I am pleased to introduce Dr. Leah Payne, whose PhD is from Vanderbilt, and she is the current Associate Professor of American Religious History at Portland Seminary in Portland, Oregon. There are many things that I could say about Dr. Payne. We met a number of years ago when we were both early career faculty at a workshop for the Wabash Center, and thinking very carefully about our identities and who we were as teachers, as pedagogues, as scholars, and what was it about who we were that shaped our work. And I have just appreciated since that time the types of conversations and the way that Dr. Payne has lived out in her scholarship, in her public scholarship, and also within the classroom and the amazing programs that are going on under her influence at Portland Seminary. And so you can read all about those in our order of program today. But what I want to say, I think, about identity and what it is that historians do and the way that she approaches the work of history that I so appreciate and want to sort of set a tone for today is something that she said in a recent podcast when someone asked her. They were like, what really got you into this work? How did you even, start grad school in American religious history? What set you on this path? And at first she says, oh, well, it's part of the family business. She's got some family background, generations of being a pastor's kid and being involved in Pentecostal churches and stuff and other places. But the other thing she said is that when she began in just your average American Christianity survey course, she realized very quickly that history can be a creative act, not a fabrication, not by that by any means, but that it can be a creative act that looks to the past in order to and interprets the past in ways that helps people understand the present. And that is one of the main reasons that she loves history. I think loves digging into places like unofficial places where influence and power and culture have occurred to shape Christianity and the American public and American politics, and that there is service in doing historical work that is creative, that is interpretive, and that I so appreciate. That you can serve a community. For Dr. Payne, it's the academic community that she serves, it's the religious communities and the American public at large. And that in doing this type of service, I love that it brings Dr. Payne and me, it's just so much joy, and so much joy and interest and life into sometimes what can be confusing and chaotic present moments. And so I just hope that you all look forward to these lectures with me. They may not be what I imagine they'll be or what you'll imagine, but it will be that creative crafting of history where we weave together all of the interesting and disparate parts, and then we have sort of a narrative that can carry us along and provide clarity for our moment. And so would you please join with me in just appreciating Dr. Payne and her visit with us and lecturing with us this morning.
Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
I'm on West Coast time, so for me, it's about 7:45 in the morning, which means the good thing is I have small children, so I've already been up for 3 hours. So I'm so happy to be here with you all, and I'm just going to, there we go, turn this on, and I'm going to start with just playing this little video here for you all.
May I see it? The brothers on this stage. We ain't nothing but a bunch of Jesus freaks! Yeah!
Test for you all. Does anybody not? No, no. Does anyone know who that is? This group that you just saw? I'm just testing my audience here to make sure. Okay, okay. All right. Who was that? No, that's okay. I put you on the spot.
Newsboys, right?
This is actually one member is now in the Newsboys.
Okay.
Michael Tate is now in the Newsboys. This is DC Talk, thank you so much, okay. And these are just a bunch of Jesus freaks you see behind you. You see this? Thank you, I like to test the waters just to see where I'm at with contemporary Christian music literacy. Congratulations, you all did a very good job. So it is my absolute joy and honor to be here with you all, and I really wanna start by saying thank you so much to the brilliant Dr. Laura Levins, and also the BSK community, because what a hospitable group of people. I've just had a wonderful time. Lexington is my first time here, a charming city. I feel like I'm in a movie set, like a Hallmark movie set. It's very beautiful, so thank you so much for your warm welcome. I'm a historian of Christianity in America, and in the most general sense, I'm interested in how things like media and technology and media culture or material culture and the marketplace shape religion and public life in the United States and beyond through unofficial, off-the-books ways. So more specifically, I'm interested in the influence of American Pentecostal and Charismatic Christianity, because if you wanna know about an unofficial, off-the-books form of doing Christianity, It's charismatic and Pentecostal Christianity, and I study it as a form of revivalism. So for centuries, under revival tents, Americans sought to breathe what they thought was new life into supposedly dying forms of Christianity, of mostly American Protestantism, through the act of reviving. And I'm not sure, I would guess, because I'm at a Baptist seminary, that most of you have some experience, even if it's not firsthand, with the practice of revivalism. I grew up in the charismatic tradition, and we're all revival all the time. And so that is something that I'm just fascinated by, how people practice the act of revival and what that tells us about the formation of those Christian communities. So in keeping with those interests, my second book is called God Gave Rock and Roll to You, A History of Contemporary Christian Music. And it's a very young book. It's only been out in the world for a little over a month. And I'm so honored to be sharing some of that research with you today. And I look at the business of contemporary Christian music as a way of understanding the formation of predominantly white evangelicalism in the United States. So, and beyond. So to frame the story of contemporary Christian music, I'd like to share one of my favorite stories that I came across doing research for this. This is the story of David Shields. In 2005, David Shields shared with me that he and his death metal band, the Skull Crushers, played a big show in Lexington, Nebraska. The Skull Crushers may not sound like an unusual name for a death metal band, and perhaps it's not, but what made it somewhat unusual is that it was inspired by a passage in the Bible, Romans 16:20, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. Skull Crushers aimed to crush the heck out of the devil that night. Their tools? Biblically based lyrics screamed over distorted guitars. The band, booked by David's cool skater youth pastor, played in the youth building of a Southern Baptist church pastored by David's dad. We were absolutely horrible, David told me years later. But the small crowd of teenaged evangelicals cheered for more. Now, I like this story so much that with David's permission, I put it in the introduction of God Gave Rock and Roll to You. David and the Skull Crushers, spoiler alert, they never made it to the big time. But his story really stood out to me because in a very earnest way, it captured the tensions and the sometimes absurdities and also the joy and the power of contemporary Christian music. Now, Southern Baptist churches of the 2000s were not widely known for being death metal tastemakers. But David and his bandmates saw what they were doing, not as metal per se, through the power of music. They were spreading the gospel according to the Southern Baptists. In a performance that was part rock concert, part religious revival, the Skull Crushers aimed to entertain and to bring audiences to Christ. They were not unique, David and the Skull Crushers. They were among thousands of bands and artists who in the second half of the 20th century performed on sanctuary stages, in youth rooms and church basements, at music festivals, denominational meetings, colleges, coffee shops, and camps around the nation. These performers, along with record company executives and publicists and booking agents and radio DJs and journalists, they were all part of a thriving industry known as contemporary Christian music, also known as CCM. And because it's a little bit of a mouthful, I'm probably going to mostly say CCM moving forward. So CCM encompassed many genres and often sounded like mainstream music or a lot like mainstream music from 18 months or 3 years previous, right? But what made it distinct is that it was created by and for and sold almost exclusively to white evangelicals. Consumed by millions, CCM was the soundtrack of evangelical conversions, worship, adolescence, marriage, child rearing, and activism. Few gatherings were complete without special music, CCM accompaniment. Now, contemporary Christian music served adults and young children, to be sure, but the industry's core consumers were suburban, middle-class, white American adolescents, and the target customer was the mother of those teens. So there was the consumer, the people who were expected to consume the music, and then the people who purchased the music, not necessarily the same person. And I'm seeing a lot of nodding heads, so I'm seeing some people whose mothers bought them contemporary Christian music, right? As digital marketing techniques developed, CCM marketers eventually gave them their own marketing persona, a digitally driven composite figure known by the name of Becky. That is a true story, and I love finding that out, right? Becky. Some of them called her Lisa, but usually the majority term was Becky. CCM marketers were not alone in recognizing the buying power of American teens, but evangelicals, and Becky's in particular, became convinced that teens were in a particularly precarious spiritual state, which meant that CCM sales had cosmic importance. For evangelical caregivers, the teen years were a must-win battlefield in the war for the future of the Christian faith, the nation, and even the world. And what I'm so fascinated by is how mass media became the means for waging that war. Mass media, they argued, was an effective weapon to be employed in that fight, and they set out to save young souls and shape the nation through music. Now, by the time David and his Skull Crushers took the stage in 2005, however, CCM was in a precarious position. Once an almost billion-dollar industry with culture-shaping power, by the early aughts, the niche was in decline. God gave Rock and Roll to You attempts to steady evangelicalism through that soundtrack, through the rise and the fall of contemporary Christian music. So for many participants, and also for many observers, the trappings of CCM, the evangelical pop stars, interpretive dancers, puppeteers, mimes, even bodybuilders, those can be seen as silly expressions of kitsch or an embarrassing remnant of a teen evangelical past. But I'd like to argue that silly things can be very serious. And CCM had the capacity to be both. Now, this book argues that these were cultural formations that were sources of power and theological meaning and even public activism. The industry, I argue, shaped and reflected the theological and political imaginary of white American evangelicalism through popular music, through revivalist rituals, and many, many forms, many, many, many forms of complementary merchandise. Now, when it comes to studying evangelicalism commercially in the United States, there are a lot of different ways to do this, and there are many interrelated industries to choose from, especially when it comes to the media. And there are books. A scholar named Daniel Vaca has written an excellent book called Evangelicals Incorporated that looks at the study of what can you learn about evangelicalism through the formation of the book industry. But I chose this industry. You could do books, you could do film, there's so many different forms, radio, theater. I chose this industry in part because of music's widely recognized power in the Christian life to move people and to incite public action. Now, why study this one industry and only one industry in the evangelical multiverse of media and marketing? So something that doesn't show up on my official bio is, as Dr. Levins mentioned, I was raised in a Pentecostal pastor's home, a Foursquare church to be exact, and my father pastored a small congregation in rural Oregon. You have not heard of this church. If you have, we should talk. You're from my very small hometown. He pastored, pastoring a small congregation in rural Oregon, and it was just outside the Mount Hood National Forest. which was a full-time job, but his church couldn't afford to pay him full-time wages. So my dad was also a roofer and a firefighter with the U.S. Forest Service, which is something that a lot of people do in that area. So as you can imagine, trees and their health and history were a big part of our local economy and our culture. And in order to check on the big fir trees in the area, to make sure they're not gonna, you know, start a fire or to make sure that they're healthy, Forest Service employees would use an instrument called an increment borer to extract a tree core, which is a tissue sample from a tree. And from that sample, you could learn about hundreds of years of history about that tree and about that forest, how it responded to extreme weather, disease, the soil, much, much more. So this idea that one tree core can tell you a good amount about the history of a forest is a guiding principle of God Gave Rock and Roll to You. By looking at one of these industries and how it changes over time, you can gain insight into the coalition of religious communities that identified as evangelical over time. And you can see how those communities changed over time. So the question that guides the research of this book is, what can you learn? What can one learn about the development of evangelicalism by looking at CCM and looking at one of the largest, most profitable, powerful forms of mass media produced in the 20th century? So I treat the CCM charts, and I'll just show you the book. This is the best looking slide because it's from my publisher. The rest are all by me. They don't look as good. I treat the contemporary Christian music charts on Billboard and also in Contemporary Christian Music Magazine, which was the Billboard of CCM, as representative of a conversation among predominantly but not exclusively white evangelicals about what kind of people they wanted to be, what kind of world they wanted to create, what kind of actions they thought would honor God. Because it was produced mostly by white evangelical men and marketed en masse to white evangelical mothers and youth pastors for consumption by children like David Shields, it's also a large-scale, multi-generational conversation about parenting and about evangelical values in the United States. Conversations about what music ought to be made, who ought to make it, and what messages it should include reveal how these communities aimed to raise their children to be ideal citizens of the kingdom of God and of the United States. So it's part business, part religious instruction, part devotional activity. The trajectory of this business shows how the marketplace and technological innovations shaped evangelical identity and ideology. I'm fascinated by this because it's a window into how capitalism shapes American Christianity in the 20th and 21st centuries. So the story of contemporary Christian music, the industry, is the story of how these communities looked to the marketplace for signs of God's work in the world. There were always notable dissenters, and in the book, if you do me the honor of reading it, you'll note that I try to record these dissenting voices, but for the most part, those within the industry regarded the prophets of contemporary Christian music as signs of God's blessing in the world. So the top-selling contemporary Christian music artists and entertainers then, they reflect a consensus among consumers about what constituted right Christian teaching about God, the people of God, and their place in public life. So certain ideas thrived and ran up the charts and stayed at the top of the charts, in large part because they appealed to these consumers and their communities. Other ideas faltered because they couldn't be easily sold. So to understand how these ideas were created and distributed on the industry side of things, I interviewed so many people. Journalists, artists, distributors, record company executives, Christian bookstore owners, and many other industry experts. But I also talked with evangelical caregivers who promoted contemporary Christian music as a form of Christian discipleship. So for that, youth pastors, parachurch leaders, popular Christian authors, and of course, evangelical moms. So to explore how contemporary Christian music influenced its listenership, all those kids that were jumping up and down to Jesus Freak, that you saw that, some of you were probably like, what is that? And others, I know, I could see, like, oh, I know exactly what that is, right? So to explore how CCM shaped its listenership, I created a survey, Contemporary Christian Music, a Survey, in 2020. And the survey invited respondents to reflect on their experiences with CCM. It was pretty open-ended. And some wrote that CCM was a peripheral part of their young adulthood, but most claimed that it shaped their lives profoundly, for better and for worse. As of 2024, I had hoped that I would get, you know, my dream was to get about 50 so that I could use them as anecdotal evidence in the book. I was very practical about the whole thing. But as of 2024, more than 1,200 CCM listeners from more than a dozen countries have participated in the survey, including the aforementioned David Shields. So I studied contemporary Christian music with all of those voices, and I really tried hard to capture the depth and breadth of experiences with the industry. So I study it as a variation, a 20th century, late 20th century riff on this long-standing ritual of revival. Now, if you grew up in a revivalist tradition like I did, you may be sort of allergic to the word ritual being attached to revival. But to that I would say, you know who the primary ritual actors were in a revival, right? If you're in a Pentecostal revival, I'll take it easy on y'all. I won't enact Pentecostal revival on y'all, but there's definitely a set crew that does set things at set times, right? It's not written down, but you know, you have your, in my church, there was always this one grandma, not my biological grandma, but this one grandma who could be relied upon to perform the, you know, under the spirit activity, right? It was always the same person. Happened around the same time, right? It was a widely recognized ritual activity where everyone had a part to play, and everyone recognized, and you definitely recognized when someone was out of step with things, right? So I love to study contemporary Christian music as a form of revival. I've always been fascinated by a ritual theorist named Catherine Bell, who argues in this book called Ritual Theory, Ritual Practice, that rituals and ritualized acts are strategic power relationships that hierarchize, integrate, define, or obscure. So in the ritual of revival, power is created and maintained and managed through relationships among preachers, music leaders, and attendees. One thing that you never want to hear at a revival meeting is silence. That's painful, right? That means the ritual is not going well. I like to study contemporary Christian music through that lens. So, in fact, CCM as a business began at a late 19th century revival. So I start this book not with the sounds of rock and roll, but with the business of revival. In one evening in 1897, an insurance business owner named John T. Benson and his piano-playing wife, Eva Green Benson, they attended a tent revival in an abandoned lot in Nashville, Tennessee, and they had a life-changing experience with a hellfire and brimstone holiness preacher. And they responded commercially. Their response was to create a business. They created a print publishing business. If you know anything about Nashville, I lived there for many years. Print publishing is the primary industry of that city, historically speaking. So they started a print publishing business to share holiness songs that would eventually become a very well-known record label named Benson Records, one of the largest and most influential record labels in contemporary Christian music. So I want to play some of the songs here for you in just a moment. But what I want to add to that is the Bensons went on to be a part of what became the Nazarene Church. It was originally called the Pentecostal Church of the Nazarene, but they didn't adopt the practices that you would associate with the name Pentecost or Pentecostal. But to sell revival songs, James D. Vaughan, another holiness musician from Tennessee, created small quartets of virtuosos who toured the country and wowed audiences by demonstrating Vaughn's sheet music and Vaughn's musical arrangements. Now, those quartets were known as Southern Gospel Quartets, and that is the birth of Southern Gospel music, if you know what it is. And so the creation of Southern Gospel was interwoven with the commercial response to revival. You know, people had an experience at a revival meeting, they create a business, and from that, we get Southern Gospel Quartets who would eventually gain popularity nationwide. Now, holiness people like Vaughn and the Bensons, they infused their songbooks with their theological visions of the world. So one thing that I think is so fascinating about the story of contemporary Christian music is that prior to this era, there weren't actually a lot of national, there wasn't national distribution of Southern holiness music. Because most publishing was located in New York and Philadelphia, most like print publishing. And so you don't get a nationwide distribution of these forms, these theological visions through song until this era. It was too expensive to create new businesses, but there were some tech changes that happened where middle class holiness, white holiness people all of a sudden could respond by creating these businesses. So they did. And they infused them with their theological greatest hits. So things like fervent anticipation of the second coming, premillennial dispensationalism, and of course, the rapture. They also favored songs like My Mother's Bible that reverberated with a really deep sense of sentimentality and a longing for Victorian norms around gender and child rearing. And they published appropriations of black spirituals like old time religion that were retooled for white Southern tastes. And this is the textbook definition of appropriation, right? And they were infused with a sentimental longing for an antebellum past. So Southern Gospel Quartets, also one of the big top-selling musical versions of these songbooks, also had a lot of patriotic standards. And they included a lot of temperance hymns to address what they saw as the most pressing social issue facing the nation and the youth of the nation, which of course, to address one of the pressing social issues of the nation at that time, which they saw as alcohol. So these patterns, and I actually want to play a little version of some of the chord music. Recognize that hymn, but it's the Great Judgment Morning. It's been covered many times, many excellent covers of that, but this is from a very well-known revivalist singer in the early 20th century, Homer Rodiever, and you can hear it's a pretty stately sound. I think of it as a pretty stately sound, but that song encapsulates a lot of those themes. It's a song about the second coming. It has a really sharp condemnation about alcohol and what it will do to you, as well as other holiness hits like gambling and things like that. So I think it's a great example of the theological and social vision that was embedded in these holiness songs. And these patterns, end times anticipation, sentimentality, appropriation, and social activism would continue on repeat for generations. So in the early 1950s, a Baptist pastor son and Baylor University graduate, Gerald McCracken, created recordings for Southern Baptist youth revivals in Waco, Texas. And this is one of the funnest stories that I came across in my research. Gerald McCracken was a sportscaster, very young sportscaster, and was invited, you know, being a Baptist pastor's son, to give a talk at a Baptist youth group in Texas about football and Christianity, which is the most Texas request, I think, you can't make that up, right? And so what he did, he went the extra mile. He was a smart, enterprising young Baptist man, and he created an imagined play-by-play footage of a football game. And I don't want to spoil it for you, so I want you to hear it for yourself. This is what he created.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is station WORD, broadcasting from the great Stadium of Life. We have for you a play-by-play description of the greatest and most important of all gridiron classics, the Game of Life. Our game here will be underway in just a few moments. And while we await the opening whistle, we'd like to point out some interesting sidelights surrounding this momentous occasion. The weather is ideal in the stadium, even though it really makes little difference, since a game as important as this one must be played regardless of conditions. There's a tremendous crowd on hand today. The stands are literally packed with a great cloud of witnesses, as the writer of Hebrews points out. Down on the field, we can see that both teams are completing their pregame workouts. To our right are the players representing Christianity. And this Christian team, by the way, has the finest of all coaches. Noted for his unerring wisdom, this great mentor, Jesus Christ, is the model of perfection in the coaching realm. However, as we look down to our left, we see another great squad and a very cunning and clever coach. This is the team coached by Satan, the forces of evil. And believe you me, this guy, Satan, and his men will be tough to handle.
It's actually really fun. It's very well done. He's 21 years old, creating this in the early 1950s, and it's highly entertaining. Spoiler, it's a barn burner, but in the end, average Christian is triumphant and victorious with his coach, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's so fun to listen to. And if you can imagine asking a young, cool young person to come in and talk to a youth group and you get this instead, this was a huge hit in Southern Baptist circles. So one was not enough. In fact, word spread around Texas and surrounding Southern Baptist areas. We want another version of that record. So I don't know if you heard, but at the very beginning, he talked about the call letters of that station were WORD, right? And so from that, McCracken and a couple of business partners created Word Records, which is another one of the huge influential, it's a CCM juggernaut. So I just love that story so much. Thank you for experiencing it with me. So you might be thinking to yourself, everything's going great. We have Baptists and we have holiness people who are creating music intended to shape the lives of young Christians. What could possibly go wrong? I submit to you, rock and roll. Rock and roll happened. Rock music turned out to be something of a puzzle for these white revivalist music makers. Few things frightened conservative white Protestant parents of the 1950s and the 1960s more than the thought of their children falling prey to the, quote, menace to Christendom known as rock and roll. So the raucous sounds of Little Richard and Elvis Presley and Jerry Lee Lewis seemed tailor-made from their perspective to destroy the faith of their young and in the process undermine the moral foundations of the United States. Now, many white American adults rejected rock and roll because of its roots in and an association with black culture. Indeed, historians like Arlene Sanchez Walsh and Randall Stevens have shown how public hand-wringing around rock and roll was often a proxy conversation to talk about black enfranchisement and civil rights. And that is well documented, and other historians have done a better job than I have. They have lots of books about that conversation. One thing that's interesting to me is how Pentecostals responded to that. So for many Pentecostals, both black and white, rock and roll was a problem not because of its association with black culture, but because it denigrated the holy sounds of church with very earthly themes of sex and driving fast cars and teenage rebellion. So, and I want to play just a little, this is just for fun, really.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much of love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
Okay, we could probably do that whole thing. I'd be here for it. But just to let you know, that might look a little orderly, but back in the day, this was very disorderly conduct, right? Look at that wild hair he's got. Pretty soon he starts, and it's fantastic. But one of the big problems, imagine being a Pentecostal, if you will, growing up, referring to the descending power of the Holy Spirit, landing like tongues of fire upon the head of the devout and calling that great balls of fire. Jerry Lee Lewis has turned this into a very thinly veiled reference to sex, right? These poor Pentecostals, I think of my mom, these poor Pentecostals, black and white, were beside themselves. They didn't know what to do about it, right? And so they tried a lot of different things. So parents and pastors, initially, they launched a crusade against it. Rock is evil. Rock will destroy you. Rock is a disease. And they launched crusades against rock music, but they were ultimately fighting an uphill battle. Right? It could not be stopped. And oops, sorry, we don't want to do Jerry Lee again. Maybe we do. But here's a picture, an anti-Elvis Presley attempt. It does, just to let you know, it didn't work very well, right? Didn't work very well at all. So these communities, they've been doing this for a long time. They've been using mass media. They've been using music for a long time. They're not going to give up, right? The music might be a problem, but they've got strategies. So when it came to developing strategies, these conservative white Protestants, they worked tirelessly to create alternatives. Here's one, a bunch of very polished, well-coiffed, shiny, beautiful teens with a jazz ensemble and a wonderful celebrity intro singing important moral lessons for the young.
Right now, we'd like you to meet one of the world's most traveled groups of teenagers. There are 23 youngsters who travel more than 65,000 miles back and forth across the country each year using songs and laughs to teach driving safety to more than 3 million high school students. Their name is the Spurlows, and they're an important part of the Chrysler Plymouth and Dodge Dealers Driver Education Program, which furnishes 12,000 cars to our high schools without charge. These kids were picked from nationwide talent auditions, and like the other six groups before them, many will go on to start. This is their first time on national television, so let's make them welcome. The Spurlows.
Lights out.
Quiet, please.
Curtain up.
Let's go.
Promises, promises, I'm gonna do it.
Promises,
promises, now I don't know how. I got the nerve to walk down. If I shout, remember, I'm the free. Now I can look at
I won't go on and on. You get the idea. But I did want to go on and on because you see a cameo from a young Larnell Harris. And if you know anything about contemporary Christian music, you know he's a huge star. But anyway, he was in the Spurlows back in the day. But I won't quiz you on that. I'll go easy on you. But one of the things that I think is just absolutely fascinating about this is, do you think they're sincere? I do. I think they're very sincere. Why doesn't this work very well, right? Why doesn't this work? We'll come back to that question. But other efforts included, hold on here. Oh, I don't keep doing that. There we go. As hippie counterculture took over in rock and folk and mainstream circles, some tried something called Christian youth musicals. And I know Baptists, if anyone grew up in a Baptist, you know, I had one of your former lecturers, Doug Weaver, who is an incredible historian of the Baptist and charismatic traditions. I had him read this section for me to make sure I had it right. And he told me that he was in a Christian youth musical when he was a young person. So I don't hope I didn't just out him there. Thank you, Dr. Weaver. You're excellent. Another group of youth pastors and Southern Baptist educators decided that they would try Christian youth musicals. And I can only describe them as folk choir extravaganzas, where clean-cut young teens would share the gospel with rebellious hippies. And ending, naturally, with hippies giving up their anti-war protests and long hair and becoming patriotic Americans for the Lord during an altar call. These were huge in Southern Baptist youth groups. The first year, this is kind of the original, the Good News, a Christian folk musical. The first year that the Southern Baptist publishing arm produced this, it outsold their hymnals. Can you believe it, right? That caused a huge sensation. And my question for you is, well, I gotta share one more. One of the creators of the Christian youth musical is a man, which I chose this picture because I like his jacket. This is Billy Ray Hearn, who ends up being a really important figure in contemporary Christian music. He was one of the Southern Baptist youth pastors who was trying to figure out how to create music to engage the young and to keep them in church. And other efforts included, I like this one, called Natural High. You could try marijuana, but you could really get high with Jesus, right? That's the message of Natural High. Tell it like it is. Look at this psychedelic artwork, right? They're trying to engage the young with the mass media language of the young, infused with the conservative messaging. And in the end, though, there's something missing here. And it's just, there's one word that can describe it. It's very uncool. Okay? And coolness is an important category, like a theoretical construct in the mid-20th century associated with resisting authority and racism and sexism, and it is countercultural behavior. It's very difficult to wed American popular culture, which is infused with this value of coolness, and put it on top of Southern Baptist ideas. So, why could these projects never pass the cool test? They were certainly performed with a lot of sincerity, 100% sincerity, I think, a lot of times, by people who, by all accounts, believed every word that they sang. Or most accounts. I'm sure there were a couple who were rolling their eyes in the back, right? But I think most of them really were enthusiastic. Why couldn't it pass the cool test? I think we can see in the lack of long-term success in these attempts, an illustration of Charles Taylor's argument that in the post-World War II era, an ethic of authenticity begins to influence popular culture. So these things maybe are sincere, but they don't read as authentic. Does that make sense? They're so polished. They're so professional. They're just gleaming, right? And that doesn't seem authentic. Okay, enter try number three.
Sipping whiskey from a paper cup. You drown your sorrows till you can't stand up. Take a look at what you've done to yourself. Why don't you put the bottle back on the shelf? Yellow fingered from your cigarettes. Your hands are shaking while your body sweats. Why don't you look into Jesus? He got the answer.
Okay, I won't go on forever with that one, but could you hear the lyrics? Right? This is, maybe you don't think this person is cool. But I'll tell you why I grew up thinking that he was cool. Salvation comes, right, in a kind of unlikely form. A surprisingly old school revival with all the apocalyptic fervor of the early 20th century swept through countercultural hippie communities on the West Coast in the 1960s and 1970s, and a new alternative emerges, the music of hippieized Christianity. So most of the young people in the late 20th century, valuing authenticity, they see in these young West Coasters who depicted really casual, expressive worship services, they saw that it read to them as authentic, an authentic relationship with God. And known as the Jesus Movement, and its members were colloquially known as Jesus Freaks. Remember that DC Talk video? Jesus Freaks. This revival was very short-lived, actually. But the music that they made, Jesus music, was a key intervention in the conversation. Now, I can't say if Larry Norman, this figure who you see right here, who's one of the kind of founding figures of Jesus music, I can't say if he's objectively cool, but I can say for sure that as the child of Jesus people, we thought he was the coolest, right? We thought, yeah, I see some heads. Yeah, look at that long hair, right? So most people of the Jesus people, most Jesus people joined the charismatic movement, right? My parents did. Which was a diverse collection of denominational and non-denominational Christians who also began emphasizing Pentecostal practices like speaking in tongues. And like their revivalist forebears, they eagerly awaited the second coming, and they read books like premillennial dispensationalist Hal Lindsey's Late Great Planet Earth, huge bestseller. Hal Lindsey's work through Hal Lindsey's work, many came to understand that the end was near because of May 14, 1948. On that day, the modern state of Israel was created. And for Lindsey, it was a day that set the end of the world in motion. This final great war, Armageddon, according to Lindsey, was triggered by the establishment of Israel as a nation. Songs like Larry Norman's classic, which became an anthem of the Jesus movement, I Wish We'd All Been Ready, which is a terrifying song, sung in a very sweet way, right? And I'll bring it up here. I like Why Don't You Look Into Jesus. By the way, I played this for a bunch of Baylor students, undergrads, who had no idea what contemporary Christian music was. And they were, 18 to 22 year olds were kind of shocked by the language. So it was actually really fun for me. I'm like, yeah, you think your grandparents aren't that cool? Get a load of this. But anyway, I digress. Songs like Larry Norman's terrifying I Wish We'd All Been Ready and a bunch of books and movies and all kinds of other music started expressing that anticipation of the end, and evangelicals responded through all kinds of creative ways, through creating their own art, more music, more literature, and also for doing things that were called rapture drills, which were sort of like nuclear drills, right? So instead of duck and cover because we're all gonna die from the bomb during the Cold War, it was you better get ready, Jesus is coming. So some, like famed Assembly of God preacher David Wilkerson, if I were at an Assembly of God church, that would have gone over so well just now. He condemned the Jesus movement. He did not like it at all. He really didn't like the music, but there were other white revivalists, people like Catherine Kuhlman and Billy Graham, who recognized that something really big was happening on the West Coast. So by combining rock and folk music of the counterculture with religious ideals and aims of conservative white evangelicals, they found Jesus Freaks and evangelical media makers like Graham gave birth to an entire genre called contemporary Christian music. I just really like this picture of Billy Graham here. This is Expo 72, a gigantic youth festival that was put on by Graham and other evangelical media makers in Texas. And so Texas is not the same as San Francisco or Costa Mesa, California, right? One of the things that I think is really interesting and important to remember is that, you know how when people used to say, if everyone who claimed to have been at Woodstock actually went to Woodstock, it'd feel like Woodstock 100 times over, right? There were like iconic hippie moments that people like to say that they were at. The Jesus movement revivals of the early 1970s, late 1960s and early 1970s are kind of like that. This little ragtag group of young people who had who'd been experimenting with drugs and sex and all the kind of trappings of counterculture, and then who ultimately found meaning through these charismatic revivals, a very small group, right? This group, Expo 72, this group is the networks of Billy Graham, right? So Billy Graham and many other conservative Baptist and holiness and Pentecostal media makers, they introduce the aesthetics of the hippies, Jesus movement, to conservative white revivalism. It goes so well, right? It goes so well from a commercial standpoint. So Billy Ray Hearn, the guy who helped create Christian youth musicals, who was a Southern Baptist youth minister turned CCM executive, he founded a label called Sparrow Records, and he signed to his roster a bunch of young music makers who were responding to that hippieized charismatic movement. And he created he kind of rounded out the big three of CCM labels. So he signed a lot of people, including Second Chapter of Acts and Keith Green and people like that. But what I want you to pay attention to is the relationship, the kind of parent-child relationship. There are young people who are making media for one another, and then there are these pastorly parent types who see its potential and put it in the commercial space. So the better part of God Gave Rock and Roll to You explores what happens next. Through the 1980s and the 1990s, contemporary Christian music labels create evangelical spins on pop music that shaped millions. And I created this montage or this collage. I know a collage kind of becomes a canon, so I'm sure you're saying, why didn't she have so-and-so up there? I actually worried about it in the middle of the night. Who did I miss? So I put some of the greatest hits up here, but I want to draw your attention to the undisputed queen of contemporary Christian music, who is Amy Grant, right in the center, right? And she's got this beautiful sort of Madonna-like pose, not Madonna the pop star, like the Madonna pose, and she's looking at the undisputed, she's the Barbie of CCM. She's looking at the undisputed Ken of CCM, Michael W. Smith, who's giving us this gorgeous come hither stare. And then you see just a ton of different versions of popular culture that was sold under the banner of contemporary Christian music. Conservative political activists saw in this group an opportunity. Contemporary Christian music and its attached suburban populations, there was an opportunity there, right? And some of it had to do with that form, the revival form. So at the height of a CCM performance, artists and entertainers were expected to perform the sign of revivalist ritual efficacy, an altar call. I don't think I have to define an altar call here in this room, but the moment where the preacher gives a welcoming sign to or gives a call for people to come forward and commit their lives to God, that became an expected part of a CCM concert. In fact, some people got angry feedback from youth pastors or moms if they didn't actually do the altar call. I talked to a lot of people in bands who were like, I don't want to do an altar call. I've never done one, you know? But you better do that. You better do that altar call. These altar calls were so effective that activists also utilized them for more than salvation or sanctification or the Holy Ghost. CCM concert altar calls were used to elicit responses among evangelical audiences about pressing social concerns. So if you want to know what these communities were thinking about, watch that moment. So concerns like abortion, prayer in public schools, teen abstinence, international aid, voter registration, promoting heterosexual marriage, traditional gender roles between men and women, and much, much more. CCM stars then played a critical role in these efforts. They were expected to be moral exemplars. And the stars with staying power, the people who topped the charts and stayed on the charts, performed and enforced very strict ideals about gender, sexuality, race, ethnicity, and class. Women like Amy Grant, who could and would be womanly according to these standards, were adored. Men like Michael W. Smith, who could and would be manly according to these standards, were admired. Those who would not or could not adhere to these standards were often marginalized, as Grant herself demonstrated when she and her longtime spouse divorced, and it shattered the image of the ideal evangelical family. And I can't tell you how many people responded to the CCM survey and talked about that moment, especially young women, what it was like to all of a sudden, one person said, they took her away from me, right? Because her music was taken off the radio and off of shelves. So this is a very serious business. I could go on and on about this, but we don't have all day, and we are at the end of our time, right? Sorry. 5 minutes. Okay, good. That's good. I was hoping. We have 5 more minutes. But what I want to suggest to you all is that contemporary Christian music is a window to observe over time the power of song, first off, to undermine traditional denominational teachings. So Baptists, for example, sang songs about premillennial dispensationalism when they borrowed holiness hymnals, even when on the book Baptist theologies of the end times were quite different. And guess what? Over time, the songs won. The story of CCM is also the story of how the marketplace consolidated, homogenized, and popularized ideals about evangelical theologies of public life. So as CCM grew, it shed the rough-edged rockers like Larry Norman, and in favor of polish and professionalism, like most of the folks that you see up here, and how through the market, ideological diversity was quickly weeded out, and so the social messaging of contemporary Christian music aligned nearly by the time of the industry's height, without exception, with the Republican National Platform. So there was considerable diversity, but that, like any market, it consolidates and homogenizes over time. The story of CCM is also the story of how the business of white revivalism benefited in concrete ways from social and political advantages that simultaneously punished black businesses of the same era. So for example, white evangelical music marketers had unfettered access to the growing wealth of the American suburb, whereas black business people excluded through redlining practices and other discriminating policies did not. As CCM flourished in its racially homogenous suburban enclaves, the story of CCM also explains, it goes a long way in explaining how white evangelicals performed these ideals in those spaces. Now, from the perspective of CCM marketers, the target audiences were white suburban moms, the Beckys, remember? Who carefully curated music for their teens. And CCM's market dominance meant that its influence went far beyond its target audience. So they had access to a lot of concrete privileges that expanded their influence, even though the target was fairly narrow. So notably, CCM served as a form of Christian catechesis for many children of immigrants whose parents were wary of mainstream culture. There are anecdotes galore in the CCM survey, but they also correspond to scholarly findings who note the influence of 20th century white evangelical media and ministry networks on communities of color in the United States and abroad. The story of CCM also reveals how, as a parenting tool, in a suite of evangelical parenting tools offered by figures like James Dobson's Focus on the Family, those spins on pop culture became conceptualized as, quote, spiritual vitamins and a spiritual vaccine meant to protect American evangelical teens from the so-called dangers of the secular world. So as it grew to be seen as this form of vaccine and spiritual vitamin, the story is also how the marketplace created consistently shifting boundaries around who was gatekeeping the evangelical Christian gospel. Who had the authority to govern the marketplace? Did denominational leaders, Christian bookstore owners, radio promoters, maybe it was the artists making the music? What happened when non-Christian corporations took over record labels? The business created a series of authority crises around who is gatekeeping, who's running this thing. For most of CCM's history, though, everyone agreed one gatekeeper above all others, the suburban white evangelical mom, the Beckys. I'm not kidding. People were terrified of Beckys. And these women, real and imagined, became the apex theological gatekeepers through their buying power. So the business creates a series of institutional gatekeepers, but the story of CCM is a story of how mothers were shaping evangelical theology. So analyzing this business, if you can't tell, I get excited about it, but it's also an opportunity to explore how holiness people, Baptists and Pentecostals, and eventually their kind of sister-cousin tradition, the Charismatics, and this is where I'll leave you before we go to lunch, how they shaped evangelicalism through song. So now there was like an odd Catholic or Presbyterian every now and then, but most of the time, almost all of the people that you see up here actually are Charismatic or Pentecostal in some kind of way, or Baptist, or holiness. So in that sense, the soundtrack of evangelicalism is not generic. It's actually a really specific group of people who are creating music that is infused with their ideas that are going out in suburbs all over the United States and beyond. So many of these people created depictions of the holiness vision of life. I know we have some folks from Asbury. Welcome, I'm so happy that you're here because the Asbury is actually really important in the story of contemporary Christian music. But the holiness tradition, if you evaluate somebody like Sandy Patty, another queen of CCM, the woman in the very sparkly but very modest dress, singing the national anthem in front of the American flag, I think it's helpful to understand her as a holiness woman who is seeking to perform ideal versions of the holiness message into the world, and to interpret the successors of Sandy Patty and the purity movement, the evangelical purity movement, girl bands like Barlow Girl or a figure named Rebecca St. James that use their altar calls to invite people to pledge abstinence, sexual abstinence. I think it's helpful to understand that as a holiness impulse. So from this perspective, it makes sense that holiness people like Nazarene James Dobson were quick to see CCM stars as ideal partners for promoting their message. So for most of the 20th century, it's a Southern Baptist story in a lot of ways. It's the story of how Baptists and their industry shaped the movement, and their political visions shaped the movement. And I started with DC Talk, because DC Talk, if you didn't know, formed at Jerry Falwell's Liberty University. And they were a reliable sound or mouthpiece of his social and political agenda. And by the late 1990s and the early 2000s, there was a lot of optimism about what this industry could do, what these spiritual vitamins could do for the youth of the kind of general evangelical sphere and for the nation. And I want to, you know, if I were giving this lecture in 1999, I would say, the future is strong, right? The future market of contemporary Christian music is strong. A couple of weeks ago, I was surprised and absolutely delighted when a person who I think of as epitomizing a certain form of Southern Baptist traditionalism, Dr. Russell Moore, a former president of the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission, the public policy arm of the Southern Baptist Convention, and editor now of Christianity Today, published a lengthy and really thoughtful reflection on my book and how artists like Michael Card shaped his life. I might be embarrassed to tell you how often, Dr. Moore wrote, in the middle of dark times, what strengthens me are words like, where there is faith, there is a voice calling, keep walking, you're not alone in this world. Dr. Moore went on to reflect on the ongoing treatment of women in CCM and how they were received and the constant pressure to appear in a certain particular way. It was a very thoughtful reflection. But if you know anything about Russell Moore, and I have a feeling people in this room do know about Russell Moore, you know that for years he was at the heart of critical conversations about the Southern Baptist Convention, and his many crises of conscience and eventual departure from the SBC are well documented. But his own testimony that Michael Card was his guide along the way was, to be honest, very thrilling to read. Because when I first proposed this book to academic presses, they're like, I don't think it's that important. Like, it's very important. It's very important. So I want to leave you all for our pre-lunchtime gathering, you will notice I didn't bring up a group, the Pentecostals. Okay? The Pentecostals who gave us rock and roll, and the Charismatics who figured out a way to utilize rock and roll. What happened to them? When we come back from lunch, I want to invite you to think about how that third group influenced the ascent of contemporary Christian music. And, dun dun dun, contemporary Christian music almost does not exist now, and we're going to talk about why. Thank you.
We've got time for a few questions. So if Dr. Payne, if you want to head back up.
I forgot there was questions.
Yeah, for just a couple of questions. So if you have one, please get up out of your seat. Please come to the center aisle here to the microphone and just line up and introduce yourself by your name and ask your question. So we've got a few moments. Anyone want to come on up? If you can't get up for some reason, I've got a mic I can give you. While people are thinking, I have one question related to McCracken. Is that what his name?
Yes, Gerald. Yeah.
Did the game end with Hail Mary?
Gosh, I can't remember, but wouldn't that be great if it did? You could have written it.
Might have been a little too Catholic for a Baptist.
Yeah, that's true. I think a Baptist in 1951 would be like, that's great.
Go ahead. Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Kevin Adams. I am graduating this semester from Baptist Seminary of Kentucky.
Congratulations.
I found this lecture to be very enlightening. It's given me, a lot of thought on what I've been exposed to that I could not name. Oh. And my specific experience, even though I grew up in a Pentecostal space, or what you can call, what we would call non-denominational, I grew up in a small black church that had a lot of associations with evangelical churches. And so growing up, I found myself in places like Tennessee, going to concerts, hearing Toby Mac and all these different things, right? And I'm like, as a young black man, I'm hearing people sing these songs, and I'm like, I don't know what this is, but I'm part of this crowd, and I'm trying to find my identity of, like, what's my space here? And you said something earlier about what I was trying to work through, and I see Kirk Franklin up there.
Yes.
Good job.
Thank you.
Because Kirk Franklin is big, but in the black community. So in terms of what I always thought was is that in the world, in this debate about, like, who influences who, right? Mm-hmm. So we talked about how CCM was responding to these things that were happening in the younger generation. So they were coming out with this music, and you hit on something about it wasn't authentic, right? And when you said that, I was like, yeah, no one wants, like, the diet, like, pop. I want, like, the real thing.
Yes, yes.
Right? And in terms of, like, the black space, there was a lot of talk about how, like, a lot of these artists were, in terms of, like, secular artists, they were saying that, hey, they started in the church, and now they're into, you know, secular space.
Right.
Has that happened at all with any of these artists or any of these?
Oh gosh, what a great question. First, thank you so much for sharing that. I really appreciate that. And you're right, Kirk Franklin, you can't do a thing on CCM and not include the great Kirk Franklin, who transcends categories, right? He charted in mainstream pop music, or mainstream music, gospel music, and contemporary Christian music. And what I found, to your point about the homogenous nature of contemporary Christian music, is I did statistical analysis, because when I first started working on this, I would talk to people who worked in the business, and I would just say sort of casually, hey, any thoughts as to why CCM was so white? Which seems obvious when you're, like, looking at CCM, but I learned that people didn't want to be asked in that way. So what I did was I analyzed the charts. And month in, month out, year in, year out, the CCM charts are about 90 to 95% white over time. There are exceptional figures. I've got Andre Crouch and the Disciples, Kirk Franklin, BBNCC, Arnell Harris, one member of DC Talk. But those are usually exceptions that prove the rule in terms of like what contemporary Christian music was and is. And I think that your question about crossover is so critical. So I hear you asking, like, kind of in industry terms, like, there are Black gospel artists who cross over into the mainstream regularly. What about contemporary Christian music? I hate to leave it on a cliffhanger, but I don't want to spoil kind of a full response later this afternoon. But what I'll say is, the very narrow theological messaging of contemporary Christian music and its association with political conservatism really hampered efforts to do crossover. So I think really, and there are scholars that would argue with me, I think Amy Grant is the only real true crossover, which is to say she built up an audience in contemporary Christian music and then became a big pop star. Whereas you can think of a bunch of examples of Black artists who grow up in Black gospel circles and then end up charting in many different genres. Amy Grant, I think, is really one of the only successful ones, and part of it has to do with the messaging. Because there is a common refrain in contemporary Christian music, the idea that the quote-unquote the world doesn't want to hear quote-unquote Christian music. At no point in time has the predominantly Christian United States been allergic to Christian themes, right? There's tons of artists who talk a lot of beautiful music that is made with Christian themes. They don't want to be talked to necessarily about keeping prayer in public schools or not having sex before you're married, especially since a lot of pop music is actually about sex. You know, it's the specific messaging, I think, that really hampered. But your point about the creative part of it. So contemporary Christian music was so responding to mainstream, that meant there was lag time stylistically, and that is death in youth culture, right? You can't be behind. You have to be like out in front. And so I think that was one of the biggest things that held them back, is they were all like philosophically, because if you go back, Billy Ray Hearn, that's who you should think of when you're thinking of contemporary Christian music, not necessarily the artists, but the industry makers who were looking for alternatives for their children. And you know, when it comes to pop music, you gotta be out there in front. Yeah, thank you so much. That was a really powerful question.
Thank you. When you show Billy Graham, it's brought back a lot of memories to me because, again, as a Black man, so I went to Billy Graham Crusades. Actually, the church, I was a part of a youth group. We were called the Righteous Rangers. We would dance and hip hop and sing.
Wait, do you have the video
yes.
of this?
Because no, I do not. If it did exist, I would like destroy it.
Aren't you glad you were born when you were born and not now?
Yes.
Because now can't
the
be
90s out. Was a crazy thing. And like I'm just a product. I'm a product of the 90s because like my dad would take me to a Christian bookstore. We spent a lot of our weekends going into the Christian bookstore, you know, and just listening to all different types of music. And I remember Billy Graham was in New York City in Central Park. He had a crusade there and Bill Clinton had showed up and our group got to dance before he got up and preached. We did our little thing, and
Whoa,
then at the end,
amazing.
We were part of the.
So you were like excellent.
Yeah, we were part of the, and at the end, we were part of the altar call.
Oh.
So we got to pray with people as they come up. So, what you're doing here in terms of like your presentation is really inspiring me because for me at this moment, where I stand in my life, it's bringing together. I guess you say I'm discovering like also like a passion and trying to figure out like how does history and philosophy and theology and all these things intersect. And I feel like this is a great example of that. So I appreciate your work.
Thank you. We need to talk because I want to hear more about your performance. That sounds awesome. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name's Catherine. Once upon a time, I went to Asbury Seminary and did get a degree. Now I have a job not associated with religion at all, and I'm just a nerd who's here today.
Yay, welcome.
but my question, actually, he picked up, he sort of stole some of my question, but
<That's> great.
It was great. I'm just kidding. But I'm the ex-evangelical world is like pretty big these days. And the number of folks now in like our 30s and 40s who grew up in evangelicalism and grew up in this culture and then left either are, you know, nuns, not religious, or actually went the other direction and went more like liturgical or something. Do you think that that means that like this influence is even extending past even what we think of as like American Christianity? And we all know that like all America like is kind of a little bit thinks they're Christian. But like, yeah, I'm just thinking like the trend, there's trends in like Catholicism and Orthodoxy and like non-religious movements that are echoing a lot of these kinds of themes and behaviors and like marketing almost. And I was wondering if that like showed up anywhere in any of your research with like where people are now who were into this when they were younger.
Oh, what a great question. Yes. Okay, I hear kind of two questions that I'll take a make a little bit of an effort toward both of them. And one is sort of what happened with these folks, the different trajectories of that evangelical alliance. One of the things that I think is fascinating is the idea that you could, like, that there is an idea that there is a coherent evangelical self, you know? Like, there's, it's always been this sort of, I think, market-driven and politically expedient networks of cooperation that can be, they can be done and then they can be undone, right? And so I think some of the ex-evangelical conversations that you see are sort of, I do think they're linked to how media created the idea of evangelicalism and how that has come under duress. A lot of it's driven by technology, like these folks who can actually communicate with each other on social media platforms and stuff like that. So there's that. And then is this world influencing other parts? I'll just give one story about that, which is I teach American religious history. So one of the things that I do is I tell my students that you need to go to a church service that's different from what you grew up in. You know, very common best practice, you know. And so I had all my students together on Ash Wednesday a couple of years ago, and I was like, we're gonna go to a Roman Catholic service. This is great. Most of the students are Protestant. So I did the whole thing, like, this is how you genuflect, and like, this is do not receive the Eucharist, like all that kind of stuff. And I thought, I'm gonna give them the most Catholic experience. Ash Wednesday, what's more Catholic than that, right? So we get up there, and during the call during the call for Eucharist, all of a sudden this song starts playing and it's, oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Okay, that's an elevation worship music. We're gonna get to worship music after. That is an evangelical song, y'all, is what I'm trying to say. And I had set up my students to have this kind of like, ooh, different experience. And I've given an evangelical altar call. So to your point, yes, it's very influential.
Chris Sanders from Louisville. So I never did as big as Reverend Adams, but my band did open for Michael Card.
No kidding. Hey!
At the Bellevue Baptist Church, Gerard Howell in Davis County, Kentucky.
Love it.
So if y'all don't know who it is, you should hear some more about Michael Card. So my question is, I was playing music in those days, which was the late 70s, early 80s. Mm-hmm. And I was into CCM, and then I heard U2.
Right.
Yeah.
And I abruptly stopped. I said, that's Christian music. That's Christian music out there in what we used to call the world. Mm-hmm. And I'm done with the subculture. So my question, I guess, is, did American pop music miss a step between involving itself in the world and then creating this CCM driven subculture that was just wasn't cool and not authentic?
I love it. You are certainly not alone. U2 was a gateway drug for many people, right? I would say that the discrete nature of contemporary Christian music was strongest in the 1980s and the 1990s. and the early 2000s. But there were always defectors for the reasons that you just said. And because U2 is deeply Christian, right? There are many very Christian themes. And I don't know a Young Life pastor who didn't use a U2 song in one shape or form, you know, over the years. So I actually see U2 as kind of an exceptional case in a lot of ways because of their lead singer Bono and his kind of his relationship to Christian communities, and because of their own roots in charismatic, kind of hippieized Christian charismatic revivals. So I think they're an unusual case. But I do think some of their later albums were condemned by people who saw them as kind of a Christian band, but then when they started singing like regular pop songs, it was, so yeah, that's a great question. Thank you.
Let's give another round of applause to Dr. Payne.
Thank you.
Before Abby Sizemore, our BSK admissions director, has an announcement, and pastor and BSK student Anthony Stevenson gives some instructions about lunch and offers a blessing, two announcements. Second lecture starts at 1:15 in this space, so please be back in here shortly before 1:15 so we can begin at 1:15. And then tonight at Joseph Beth Booksellers at 7 p.m., there is a book signing event with Dr. Payne. So please come out to Joseph Beth at 7 p.m. tonight. Abby.
I'm Abby Sizemore. I'm the Director of Admissions at BSK, and I am here for one specific announcement, but I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't direct you to the pamphlets that are on your tables while you're eating lunch. On those tables, we have our generic brochure that mentions all of our programs, and we have a new Master of Arts degree that's launching in the fall. I think Dr. Cassidy already mentioned that. But we have flyers for that program as well, and those can be your party favors. So please take them with you when you leave, take them back to your churches, and share them with people who might be interested. And if any of you have any questions, I'd love to talk to you about our programs. One specific announcement that I have is about the BSK banquet that's happening on April 19th. We have this banquet every year in conjunction with CBF Kentucky's Spring Gathering. And this year it will be happening at Calvary Baptist Church in downtown Lexington. Many of you have already attended that banquet in years past, and if you haven't, we'd love to invite you, and you can register for that on CBF Kentucky's website, which I believe, Bob Fox, is cbfkentucky.org. That's how much I love you. I have it memorized. cbfkentucky.org. CBFKY, excuse me, .org. So please register for that banquet. It'll be at 5:30. On April 19th, and that's cbfky.org. And now Anthony is going to do our prayer.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am here to give some directions and announcements. First of all, can we just give God a hand praise for Dr. Payne right now? Also, the announcements are just a few announcements. Lunch will be served in the gymnasium, which is, if you go out the sanctuary to your right, lunch will be served there. Also, the meal for today, this is good, y'all. It's been prepared by Joseann's Homestyle Kitchen, a black-owned, locally-owned restaurant here in Lexington. Some of you all know. If you don't know, ask Dr. Brogdon. He drove all the way from Louisville for the cabbage. So he shared that with us in class. So some of us showed up today because of what he said. So we're excited about the meal today. In addition to that, we are also excited that our own BSK, Miss Abby Sizemore, has prepared the desserts for today, her special cakes. So congratulate her before you eat it. and let her know how appreciative we are for her as well. Let us bless the food. Lord, we come now to bless the food that's been prepared for the nourishment of our bodies. Lord, we thank you for the hands that prepared it. Lord, we thank you for the resources that provided it. And Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to partake of it. And Lord, we want to be mindful to pray for those who are without adequate food, clothing, and shelter. We pray, God, that you will bless now as we partake of this food. And we ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Every heart say amen. 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 You may dismiss for lunch.